Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for frame rate is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Framerate is brought to you by Shutterstock.com. With over 900,000 high-quality video clips, Shutterstock helps you take your creative projects to the next level. For 30% off your new account, go to Shutterstock.com and use offer code Framerate4. Welcome to episode 120 of Frame Rate. I'm Tom Merritt.
I'm Brian Brushwood. If you can hear me over this iPad connection from St. Louis, just outside of my show.
Little damper on the festivities today. If you have been following the news, you know, just a couple hours ago as we're recording this show, two explosions at the Boston Marathon in Boston. Not our place to cover it on this show, but we do want to acknowledge that it happened and express our sympathies to those. Apparently, at least two dead, several dozens and dozens, maybe hundreds injured there. If you are looking for information about this, go to the news sources. If you're watching us live, go check those out. We will make the show available on demand. That's why it's at twit.tv/FR. If you're looking for family members, 617-635-4500 is the phone number for that. If you have information, the number is 800-494-TIPS. There's a Google person finder out there as well. It's being crowdsourced, a Red Cross person finder. And, of course, it's always important to give blood at times like these, redcross.org. We're not going to try to put a tech angle on these events, but we did want to acknowledge them and, as I said, express our sympathies. And the rest of the show is just going to be a normal frame rate show. So, Brian?
Starting with...
Shall we bring in our guests?
Yeah. Oh, wait, yes. I was just going to jump right into the big story and just have them sit there awkwardly. It's a much better idea. Let's bring them in.
From This Week in Geek, the founder of thisweekingeek.net, we're happy to have Steve Saylor from Toronto, Ontario, Canada. How's it going, Steve?
I'm doing excellent. How about you guys?
We're doing well. Thanks for joining us today. Also, because it was the premiere of his brand new show on the TWiT Network just yesterday, This Week in YouTube's host, comedic vlogger Lamar Wilson. How's it going, Lamar?
Doing great. Good to be here. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thanks for being on the show. Jam-packed with guests, and we start with the big story.
This just in, the big story.
Brian, we cannot get away from this. It's Aereo and the Great Bluff. Now,
it just keeps getting Moonbiz bigger. Okay, so I don't know if I just had a Skype hiccup or what, but the thing that drives me nuts about these guys claiming that they're going to go subscription only is, number one, like, we got word that people, after last week, they pointed out that they had all kinds of NFL contracts that demanded that they carry locally. Is that correct?
Well, we heard some stuff like that. Then we also heard people say, well, they could get around that by doing live streaming like they do with the Super Bowl. So what we're hearing now is that Fox affiliates say, we're on board with the plan to move to pay TV. We would just have a separate signal for anything that we're required to broadcast over the air by our FCC license. And we would, all the primetime stuff would go to cable. And I guess they would be fine with that. CBS saying we would look at this too. And meanwhile, Aereo, full speed ahead, is marketing like crazy and looking ready to start new markets.
So the when they send their signal to local cable providers, the cable companies have to charge a fee, and they get paid. The affiliates get paid by the cable companies to rebroadcast. Is that correct?
Yeah. Remember, we've gone over the. It's kind of complicated. There's a must carry law that confuses the issue that says the cable companies have to carry you if you want them to. Or, as a local channel in the U.S., after the 1994 Act, you can opt out of must carry and then bargain for them to pay you.
Okay. So here's what I'm getting at is, what drives me nuts is, when we first talked about this story, they were so offended that Aereo was, I'm using air quotes here, stealing their signal, rebroadcasting it without paying a license, then that they're so upset by it that they're going to take their ball and go home was what it sounded like to us. But now it sounds different. Now it sounds like, well, if Aereo is going to exist, it's not fair that apparently consumers are comfortable paying $7, $8, $9 a month in order to get clear signal, and we're not the ones getting that $7, $8, and $9. So now it sounds much less like them saying like someone is ripping off our signal. Now it just sounds like they're saying, well, if there's money to be had, then we want it, and so we're going to go subscription based then.
Well, yeah, and essentially they want to protect that money. They don't want people to go to Aereo and not get a cut of what Aereo has. So there's two escape routes here. One is they strike a deal with Aereo for licensing, and the other is they go to Congress and get Aereo's exception ruled out. That is if Aereo wins the court case, which still has to happen.
Now, why wouldn't they? Why wouldn't they immediately start working with Aereo?
Because they don't want to they don't want to piss off the cable MSOs. Remember, the cable people are out there going, don't you dare strike a deal with Aereo. We are the monopoly in every region that delivers your local channels to people. So you want to maintain this relationship with us because we've got all your other channels that you broadcasters have. Because remember, all these broadcasters have multiple cable channels as well as their big broadcast channel.
Yeah. Well, they're jerks, all of them.
Lamar, have you been following this?
I have, and I just – a couple of thoughts. I think this is pretty ridiculous because, number one, I don't see how they are going to lose money on this. It's just someone else producing the feed. I'll give you an example from my place that I have here in L.A. When I was in Chicago, I had an over-the-air antenna, get every major local channel. Here at this particular place, I can't get it just because of where my apartment is. And so a service like this would make sense. The, Fox and CBS would not lose any money. I will still be watching them, but I can finally get a signal even if it goes over the internet because I can't put an antenna out here and get the signal that I'm supposed to get for free. I cannot wrap my head around why every time a new technology comes out, they feel like they have to get some extra money out of it or they're going to lose out of it if someone else provides a better service.
That's the weird part because like Aereo's only crime is providing value and making the pie bigger. And they're sitting there just watching Aereo provide a service that people want. And they're just so mad that they can't have it, that they're going to shut it all down. It's,
well, don't forget that they make less money off the over-the-air viewers than they make off the cable viewers, right? Because they can get the fee and sell the ads to the cable viewers. So what they're seeing with Aereo is eating into that money pie that they actually – they're willing to tolerate those fading number of people with rabbit ears as long as that number keeps declining. But if Aereo comes in and starts making that number go back up, then their business model's screwed.
But
Steve, this must look crazy to you from Canada, right?
Oh, you crazy Americans. It basically, the way I see it, like I have not had actual TV in my home because the same thing as Lamar, my apartment just doesn't get a proper signal. So being able to watch live TV, that is the only crux of everything that everything I watch online. It's like, I want to watch everything online. I want to be able to watch it on my own. And watching live programming like, say, the Super Bowl or any live sort of award show, that kind of thing, I don't have that access. But having a service like Aereo, I would love that. The problem is, at least here in Canada, is that generally whenever you guys get something first, we have to wait about a couple of months to years to when we can finally catch up. But if they had this service day one in Canada, I would sign up in a heartbeat.
You know, there's always a VPN. I'm just saying.
So I got a quick question.
There's ways of getting it.
my quick question is, Tom, for what you were saying, are there different ads that are run on the local Fox that's over the air than the one on the cable company? Because it seemed like if there's ads, they're still getting money. That's why I'm confused.
But on the cable company, they get money from the cable company for carrying the channel in a lot of cases, in addition to the money they're getting for the ads.
It's just like the Hulu Plus thing. Like Hulu Plus, you pay a monthly service and you still get ads. It's once you've tasted that double dip income, it's very difficult for your networks to want to give that up.
Oh, so they're just being greedy. That's all.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right there.
Built the
now I don't know. I don't know if you got what you guys have in the States, but what we do is like we don't have anything sort of live streaming over the web, obviously in Canada. But what we have is that for each sort of major network channel, like CTV or City TV or Global TV, you can be able to get an actual iPhone app and be able to stream all their programming, and they just sort of cut in every time there's a commercial break with an actual ad, similar to what you guys have with Hulu. Each channel or each network has their own individual app that we can be able to get. And personally, I would prefer that. If say NBC, CBS, or Fox had their, or I don't know if you guys have it, their own individual app, I would like. I don't need to have live streaming TV. I can just watch the shows on there.
Well, the one thing I could tell you, no matter what happens, when you have big organizations, don't forget, Aereo's backed by Barry Diller. He's a legend in the entertainment industry. So you've got big people fighting. It usually means the consumers win in the end, because you've got lots of battles up at the top. It's when the big companies all get along that we end up losing out. And there's a smaller company that's making waves called Dish Network, and they're making some news today. That's another big story.
Oh.
Ooh.
It's another big story.
Stop everything. It's another big story.
So Dish is doing two things. One is they've got a pile of cash that they're looking to do stuff with. Don't forget, these are the guys who made the Hopper, which automatically records all of primetime television, and then 24 hours later allows you to watch it without commercials automatically, without having to use your fast-forward button. That's why CBS told CNET they couldn't give the Best of CES award to the Dish Hopper, because they're mad about that. Earlier this last week, Bloomberg Business Week reported that Dish might be looking at making a bid on T-Mobile in order to get into the cellular game. And then today, DealBook at New York Times reports that Dish is making a $25.5 billion bid for Sprint Nextel. SoftBank, Japanese company, looked like a lock to buy Sprint Nextel, and Dish comes wading in with their big money bags and saying, like, you know what, actually, we'd like to do this.
Well, and this is huge. The moment I heard this morning, it seemed perfect because, you know, Sprint is your third-place carrier that is, because they're in third place, they're making bold decisions like, unlimited data, yes, for reals, unlimited. And, meanwhile, Dish, of course, being a third place, I assume, or fourth place provider, is able to do outrageous stuff like the Hopper. Once, if those two were to team up and that culture of taking big risks were to continue, I could see all kinds of deals where it's like, if you have Dish, Dish without the Dish, basically, every single channel all on your phone available at any time. And I don't know how much of that is possible with their current agreements, but it's pretty clear that they don't mind that certainly the Dish side of thing doesn't mind ruffling some feathers in a very pro-consumer stance. So this could be great.
It could be, right? I mean, we look at this and you say, well, obviously the television networks are never going to allow a cell company to stream things over the internet. On the other hand, if you look 20 years down the road, the idea is, well, maybe eventually we just get rid of over-the-air broadcasting altogether, TV, radio, and everything is just wireless internet so that you can get whatever information you want. This could be a baby step down that road. Lamar, am I crazy talking?
No, I think you're absolutely right. I think Brian is right. My problem has always been with Dish. I do not like them. I didn't like when they had to fight with TiVo. I didn't like when they got Slingbox because it just seemed like things just went bad on those services that I liked, or the legal battles they had with TiVo. I know Sprint needs to be under someone. They're not doing that well in the U.S. I'm not sure if Dish is the company to come in and save them. But you're spot on about having everything online, wireless, get rid of the middleman, get rid of the over-the-air, and just have everything on the internet. It's going to go there eventually. Is Dish the company? I'm not sure.
Steve, what do you think? Is Dish the company?
Yeah, I think it could be. It has a definite sort of gravitas towards it, I guess. But I mean, at least in Canada, every sort of thing is made is owned by the big three. There's Bell, Rogers, and Shaw, and they kind of already have this in place. You can buy a cell phone plan and a TV plan and a phone plan through them, and they also provide like their own sort of services for online streaming video. Like, especially Rogers, they have their own app that you can be able to, as long as you're a Rogers TV subscriber, you can be able to watch all their programming on there. So I think that definitely this is a step in the right direction.
All right, let's take a quick break and thank our sponsor, Shutterstock.com. This episode of Frame Rate brought to you by Shutterstock. You'll find the perfect image or video for your next creative project at Shutterstock, whether it's for your website, whether it's a publication, an advertisement, you're making a commercial, just a documentary, any kind of video. They've got, you might think Shutterstock, right? I know they've got great clip art. They've got over 900,000 high quality stock video clips, 2D and 3D. They've got animation. They've got motion graphics in there. They have clips in a variety of digital formats. Most of them come in HD. And the cool thing about Shutterstock is they source their video clips from around the world and put them at your fingertips. So many of the contributors are professional filmmakers and animators. You can use their work legally in your work. Shutterstock curates this stuff. They review each video individually for content with loving care before they add it to their library. But they do a lot of them. They're adding over 10,000 video clips a week. So every time you visit, you're definitely going to find something new. And they give you video content you need to bring your creative projects to the next level. You can search by category. You can search by resolution, by contributor. If you start to find somebody you're like, I really like their shots, you can find them. And a shareable clip box. So you can access them anytime and share with your team members. They also have a huge image library. We talk about that all the time. Photos, vectors, icons, infographic templates, all that good stuff. I use that stuff on It's a Thing all the time. Shutterstock has flexible pricing too. You can choose between individual clips, or if you're going to be using a lot of stuff, you might want to get a video pack. You can download clips in HD, or you can buy standard definition or web formats. If it's just for a web video, why spend the bandwidth that you don't need to? Shutterstock is a complete global offering. They have offices located in more than a dozen companies, Germany, China, and look for cats. Just look for cats and you'll be impressed. You might think, well, I can find cats on the internet. They got some impressive cats there at Shutterstock.
Tom, can I actually mention something?
Sure.
I will say this. I am a big proponent of Shutterstock. I work for a radio station. I call myself the blind graphic designer because I am one. And I use Shutterstock all the time for all the projects I work for in the at the radio stations I work at. So
when you say use it for the radio, you're putting video on the web or images on the web?
Mostly images, definitely, like, because I'm the digital content producer there. So everything that goes on the web is all done through me. So everything.
Because I know there's some smart aleck out there going like, well, radio, what do you need images for? But it's the kind of website.
Well, yeah. And we keep saying that radio is going to die eventually soon. But I know I still have a job. That's all I know.
That's right. You're on the right side of that equation. We'll try Shutterstock today, folks. So sign up for a free account. You don't need a credit card or anything to just try it out. Start an account. Begin using Shutterstock. Help imagine what your next project could be like. Save some video selections. Get yourself some job security like Steve Saylor. Save some stuff to a clip box. And then if you do decide to purchase, use the offer code FRAMERATE4 and new accounts, get this, receive 30% off any package. So don't forget that. Shutterstock.com for 30% off new accounts. Use the offer code FRAMERATE4. We really thank Shutterstock for their support of FRAMERATE. Let us move on to the slipstream. So, appropriate story to have along with the host of This Week in YouTube with us. YouTube for iOS gets access to some new stuff now, which means you can AirPlay it over your Apple TV, live streams, your subscriptions feed, and video queuing. So you could load up a bunch of clips, AirPlay them, sit back, and just watch some television. What do you think of this, Lamar?
Yeah, I like that AirPlay type of thing. You pretty much can queue up and even in some kind of offline mode and just watch it when you want to. I like the live stream support. I believe Android has this now. The one thing they updated, I'm using air quotes like Brian did earlier, with the subscription thing.
Aerial quotes.
Yeah, aerial quotes that I don't like is that this. It used to just say home feed, like it shows in the picture. Now it has two sections, what to watch, which is your default always. You can never change it. And your subscription feed, which means if you want to watch your subscriptions first, it's one extra step that you'll have to take. And, of course, that hurts content creators as myself because their YouTube is pushing out things that they think you might want to watch versus things that you actually subscribe to. And so it's a bummer. I wish they wouldn't enforce that on people, but I know why they do it. It's just to keep the stream of different content coming to someone who wants to just watch videos for like 10 minutes if they're in a grocery line. But Comcast, yeah, overall, it's great. Sorry.
No, that's cool. Comcast confirmed that they will now start encrypting basic cable They have alerted their customers in some markets that it will now encrypt basic cable signals, forcing them to order a digital adapter if they want to continue to receive basic program through the service. This was something that a lot of cord shavers were doing, was like cutting out all but the most basic subscription to Comcast. And then you could get the basic channels through any wire in your house. Brian, I mean, this was awesome.
Well, and yeah, and what I don't understand, it's like, it's this is their service. Like, was the consumer doing something like stealing, watching channels that they weren't supposed to? Or I guess their problem was that people could hook up as many TVs throughout the house
problem,
as they
Brian,
wanted.
Consumers were watching channels without paying an extra fee to rent a box.
So now they're just going to have to pay a rent. So is this really, are they going to have to pay for the box now? They're just deciding everyone needs a box?
Well, yes and no. I mean, this actually leads into one of our other stories in when we get to Tube Tops. But certain boxes, like Boxy Box, are able to decrypt. So right. you can still buy your own box, but you still need a box. That's the key.
Okay. Well, it's more whatever. I mean, like, what can you do? I mean, it's like this is like griping about the post office being slow. You know, newsflash. You know, Comcast wants more money. Consumers not going to have a better experience as a result. I mean, this,
right? It's tax day. Can you believe they took taxes?
Apparently, it's busy at the post office.
Now we were talking about Aereo and how they've so far won in court. They've avoided an injunction. The judges had said on the face of it, it doesn't look like this is illegal to rent out an antenna and stream it to an individual. However, a Los Angeles federal court disagreed, and they're ordering a halt to a startup company called Aereo Killer, which is started by someone named Alki David. You may be familiar with him as the creator of Filmon, an attempt to stream all kinds of internet channels onto an iPad app and over the internet without permission. He has gone after CBS in the past, so I think he probably decided to do Aereo Killer because CBS was mad about Aereo. And he was providing local stations via remote digital antennas, but not geofencing them. That was the significant difference. Still, in the U.S. District Court in L.A., they noted the other Aereo case in the Second Circuit Court and said, cases there have held that where a transmission of a work over the internet is made from a copy of a work made at the direction of and solely for the use by a single user, there is no public transmission. But the L.A. court disagreed, said, we think that is a copy, and therefore that's a copyright infringement.
So this thing, okay. Well, I mean, I don't even know where to begin on this one. The distinction is, forget it. I got nothing.
Steve, does this make any sense to you?
No, it doesn't.
Essentially, let me try to break it down. You've got the Second Circuit Court looking at Aereo, and they haven't actually gone through the full trial yet, but they're saying, look, on the face of it, we don't think having an antenna sending a signal over the internet to one person is a public performance, and therefore there's nothing illegal here on the face of it. We still have to go to trial, but we're not going to put an injunction out. In L.A., you have a court saying, actually, we think that's a public performance because the internet is public. So even if it's only going to one person,
but
that's a public
this guy's
performance.
Setup. This guy, and by the way, nice jerk move calling it Aereo Killer, just so we can muddy the waters of this even more. So Aereo Killer is essentially a straight-up ripoff of exactly what Aereo's doing, only he didn't geofence. And
correct.
That's the difference?
As I understand it, that's the only difference.
Mm-hmm. Or just the courts in L.A. just have a different opinion. Now, keep in mind, L.A.
Both
is,
of those
course,
are true.
A big...
He didn't geofence, but right. Then the L.A. court also ruled that we think this is a public performance.
Huh. All right. I got nothing, man. This is just going to get nastier and nastier.
It's definitely not precedent setting for the Second District Court. So this might all end up having to get worked out in the Supreme Court at some point. But we'll keep an eye on it. Let's go to Tube Tops. So Boxy, as I mentioned, they have the Boxy DVR that allows you to record in unlimited amounts in the cloud, but it's only in certain markets because they're trying to limit the bandwidth that they're using. They're going to roll it out to more markets. Avner Ronan said so, and they're starting to do that. But they've also changed the name. It's no longer Boxy TV. It's Boxy Cloud DVR, and they're de-emphasizing. They haven't changed the capability of the box, but they're de-emphasizing that free TV revolutionary aspect of it.
Yeah, I actually am okay with this. Of course, what makes this newsworthy is what? It's like 4 months ago this thing came out, and then they're already rebranding it. And the big change is from calling it Boxy TV to Boxy Cloud DVR. I think it's a legitimate reason to rename it, because I did always think of Boxy as a streaming device like a Roku. But when it can do so much more, like with the Cloud DVR, you know, then if you're having a problem of getting that through to customers, my guess is that they also looked and saw that the market for DVRs is probably a lot bigger than the market for streaming boxes. So you want to compete on that bigger playing field. So that all makes sense to me. It's a little bit of a bummer to see them de-emphasizing what made them great. You feel like, you know, they're getting a little cozy, obviously, because we're talking about the what's that encryption thing that they got a little special handshake deal with the cable providers,
right?
Even when basic cable is encrypted or whatever, I'd imagine that there's a lot of this in, like, all right, Boxy, you're not going away. Let's at least cozy up and be friendly. And I'm not saying any kind of like nefarious backroom deals. I'm just saying, if you want to get something done, you know, you do some give and take, and you change your tone. So Boxy's getting a little less punk rock. They're putting on a nice suit. They're combing their hair, hoping to I assume, getting a lot more homes.
So you're saying Boxy's all grown up?
A little bit. Makes me a little bit sad. They were pretty punk back in the day.
Yeah, but you know what? They got that. They've always got that root. That they've always got that part of them. Can't deny it.
Sure.
Yeah. I'm in the market. I believe it's in the LA market for this. My only, as I was reading a lot of comments on this, and one of the, I guess, unsettling things about Boxy is that they keep changing, or they lose support, they stop support on a product, and so I'm afraid if I go buy this right now, will I be left in the dark a few months if they decide to change their gears again? So yeah. I don't know what to think about that.
That's the worry, right? When you're relying on a cloud service.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I always had the same thing with like pretty much any major streaming box, whether it's the Roku or the Boxy. Like, I tried a whole bunch of them, and they just didn't. Some functionalities worked, some functionalities didn't. Now, granted, some of that was because I was in Canada, and some things just didn't work. But still, there was a lot of other functionalities that things kept taken away, and eventually I had to settle on an Apple TV because it just worked right out of the box, and it's pun intended. And it just I absolutely love it. Like, the Apple TV is hands down my favorite out of all of them.
Well, Microsoft wants to change your mind, Steve, because they're going to introduce a whole bunch of new features to the Xbox that'll make it the one set-top box you need, except for that other set-top box you need to decode your cable signal. But the Xbox will control that box, so you'll forget it's even there, because everything will be piped through the Xbox. This is actually the way the Google TV works. Everything is piped through and controlled by HDMI. So what they're telling The Verge, sources are, is that the Xbox will require an online connection to use the entertainment service, not the video games, allowing them to be always on for streaming and access to TV signals. And you'll be able to say, I want to watch this show. And they'll say, oh, it's on your cable service on this channel. It's on demand cable on this channel. It's also on Netflix here. And you'll get all of that in one interface.
Okay, so here's the thing, Tom. This is almost exactly what we hoped Google TV would do. So I'm very excited. I just wonder if it'll actually be that, you know? And it's like, I thought, you know, we've talked about this on the show before. Xbox is a tremendous amount of hardware sitting in living rooms all over the place. This makes a lot of sense. Universally, all these people, it's the babysitter problem, right? It's the fact that when their babysitter comes over, you got to explain how to get which thing on which gizmo and to switch which thing. If they can solve that problem and crack that code and have a beautiful interface that makes it, again, as we say on the show, easy to watch what you want to watch when you want to watch it, then they'll make all the money in the world. They'll win all the dollars. But I don't know. I've been burned so many times.
I agree. I've been burned several times. I know I sort of gauge the barometer with my mom. My mom, she loves watching Survivor on TV, and she can never seem to find it no matter what box she's using, whether it's the Xbox, the PS3, or just our DVR cable box. And I mean, it's just every single thing we try over top of that, like I always have to use the phrase that my teacher once told me, polish a turd, it's still a turd. So being able to put a slick interface over top of it, it still doesn't work the way I want it to. So I'm hoping that the Xbox will be able to do it.
Does it drive you nuts when you walk into the room and your parents are watching like the standard definition version of a channel that you know you're paying to get in HD?
Oh my lord, like, yes.
And they're like,
I'm like, I tell my mom all the time, it's like, okay, you know there's much better quality of channels on here. And she's like, yeah, but I only know how to work this one remote, and that's the only remote I'm going to use. And I'm like,
my grandma's solution for that, I'm watching like a channel on ABC in regular definition, which she clearly had high definition, was to stretch it. And she's like, look, Lamar, I'm watching it HD. I was like, God, no.
Oh, yeah. No, my father-in-law, same thing. Same damn thing.
My dad, the same thing, but he does it with movies. He can't stand the black bars, so he'll constantly zoom in to everything. And I'm like, no, what are you doing? Please, God, no.
Stop it. You're mangling the picture. Well, you can't do that with a Roku, but that's still got a babysitter problem of its own. However, they've sold 5 million of these things. They've streamed 8 billion videos and music tracks, but they are shutting down Video Buzz, which was one of the ways you could sneak YouTube onto Roku. Were you aware of the Video Buzz, Lamar?
I didn't hear Video Buzz. There was one private channel that was right before this when I had a Roku, and I forget what it was called, but it was abruptly shut down a few months later by YouTube, and I knew it would happen again. It must be some licensing issue that Roku's not willing to pay Google for this.
My wife works for YouTube, but I don't have any inside knowledge about this. My guess is that because this has been the problem with apps sometimes, is they want the ability to stream ads in a certain way, and if the platform can't handle it, then they won't authorize an app for it. It's my guess that that's what's going on with Roku.
Go ahead.
Oh, no, sorry. Has Roku ever had, the actual YouTube channel? Because I remember having a Roku XD a couple of years ago, and I was able to stream YouTube just fine and never got rid of it was on there for about a year or so that I used it for.
There were unofficial versions of it. I don't know if there's ever been an actual official version. There might have been in the early days. I could be wrong about that. But I'm pretty sure all of those were unofficial.
The ad thing makes me wonder what you say, Tom, because I have the Apple TV and it looks YouTube looks great in there, but it doesn't look any different from watching Netflix on there. And I never see ads in it versus if I go to my Xbox, I do see the ads in there. So I wonder if you know, what kind of deal maybe Apple has to get that in there.
They struck that Apple deal a long time ago. So it may have been before they started paying attention as closely.
Absolutely.
Meanwhile, this one's tailor-made for you, Steve. 8% of Canadians now cord cutters who no longer watch traditional television. That's double what it was in 2007, 6 years ago.
Yeah, actually, it's interesting. Like every sort of one of my friends in Toronto, they don't subscribe to any regular cable service. They are getting it all through on the air or just online through Netflix or whichever. There's even sort of a big thing of like it's sort of a big movement to be able to have access to American stations and Netflix and stuff like that. There's two services that are sort of competing. There's called Unblock US and Blockless, where for $5 a month, you can just change the DNS address on your router and everything in your house can be able to have access to American content. I use it all the time for Netflix and it just makes it look like, oh, I'm traveling in the US. And you guys U.S. is basically like the wonderful Emerald City of Oz to us because in regards to content, because you guys have so much stuff that we just want to be able to watch. And,
well, sure. And then we get all whiny because we can't catch like the latest BBC show and then start stamping our feet.
Here's my question. So you've got there are governmental regulations and laws that says so much of our broadcast television content has to be Canadian made. We don't want to be, you know, America's hat or whatever, you know, things. So you sort of create this gray market where you have all this content in America. And of course, America, you know, Netflix is blocked if you're in Canada for, you know, X, Y, and Z purposes or at times and so on. And you get all these people who learn these workarounds and you have these services that exist only to create weaseliness. And I would love to know if there are any studies on piracy of video content in Canada versus in the United States, because by creating this normalized, weasel market, basically, it makes me wonder if it's like, well, if you're already weaseling to get, you know, pretend like you're in the United States in order to watch U.S. television. You know, Game of Thrones, just grab it, Pirate Bay or whatever. Like, have you, can you speak, you don't need to out any of your friends or anything, but is there anything to that, do you think?
Yeah, definitely. There has, like, being able to get like American content or just content that we just can't get in Canada that we would love to be able to get, and we would no problem be pay legally to get access to this content. We just sort of go which whatever means are available to us. And one of the things that we've sort of seen is I think I remember reading a study or something like that that Canada is probably one of the most pirated countries in the world in regards to being able to have access to content. And the thing is, like, they're actually – the government of Canada does add certain things here and there. There actually was for a period of time back when sort of the MP3s and Napster sort of was a big thing, they actually put a small tax on every single CD or burnable CD that you purchase, and that goes to the government to be able to pay out to the RIA equivalent, and it would so that way the artist can still be able to get money off of burning CDs, because it was very minuscule and it wasn't really noticeable. And it's sort of when I talk to people about that, they're like, "Oh, what, really? That actually happened?" It's like, "Yeah, but it wasn't that huge of a deal." So I wouldn't put it past at least the government of Canada to have something, maybe put something in place that we can be able to still get content outside of Canada.
Also, well, as far as I understand it, by law in Canada, when you start to pirate a file, you have to say, "Really sorry about the piracy."
No, actually, if you read the exact letter of the law, it's you have to say, "Sorry about the piracy."
We apologize for stealing your content, eh?
I was going to say, Steve, this never would have happened if you all had not canceled Flashpoint, one of the greatest shows ever. That was Canadian-based.
You know what? It was you guys. You stole our content by putting it on networks, and that just show up.
I love that show.
It's all karma. It all goes around. All right, let's get into some film foul. A couple of things in Film Found today. These are the stuff that we like to watch. We got a first little look at the Japanese live-action Gachaman movie, G-Force for those Anglophiles out there, or Battle of the Planets, perhaps you might know it as. First look at the Science Ninja Team. Not much, just kind of them in their helmets, but they look a lot more badass than the bird-looking people from the cartoons, which I totally loved.
Yeah, but, yeah, you got to immediately cover your ass on that one.
Yeah, and I did. I absolutely love G-Force.
Dude, this next story, and I'm upset that I can't see anything because of my internet connection being on the road, but this second story with the sci-fi announcement of Childhood's End, that is, like, easily my all-time favorite Arthur C. Clarke book.
Yeah, Larry Niven's Ringworld and Arthur C. Clarke's Childhood End are going to be made into, what, miniseries? Is that right, for sci-fi? But sci-fi making sci-fi
is unheard of.
It's an odd home for science fiction content to be on network sci-fi.
I think weird them as weird thing. A wrestling channel.
It's good for them to.
What is this sci-fi or sci-fi you speak of? Because we have an actual a channel called Space that, you know, I'm just saying it's better.
Yeah, but where do you put Lord of the Rings? Because that doesn't happen in space.
It could.
I guess we work around that.
Pretty amazing. I would totally watch the hell out of Lord of the Rings in space.
I'm scared of watching anything on sci-fi, man, because you get into these series and they're just notorious for canceling, and that's just the worst thing. Just you get emotionally invested and they rip it from you. So I'm hoping that if these are miniseries that they're short and they end well and they don't try to stretch them out and then take it away from you.
Didn't they try to do this a couple of years ago, though? I remember hearing something about sci-fi wanted to be able to make a miniseries off of these shows.
Off of these particular ones? Because they've done Dune in cooperation with other networks around the world. And they've done Pern. I think they did some Dragon Rider stuff. But I don't remember these particular ones. Maybe they have been in development for a while. Mm-hmm. I'm going to take a blind leap here. I don't know if we have an opening for it or not. But it's time to cover the first week of the summer movie draft.
Bow, 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 movie draft.
That's yeah. right. This is summer movie draw. So this week it's Oblivion. It's Brian Brushwood's movie. What's your odds? Tom Cruise and Morgan Freeman.
Obviously, big star power. The early part of the reason I paid as much as I did for Oblivion was banking on, and it's projected to do 140 to 160 million. It might maybe a little bit less now, down to 120. But the stuff I had seen like 6 months ago had me super pumped. But the way they're marketing it now, it just looks like the Matrix light. You got this faux Morpheus thing happening, and I'm actually less confident in it now than I was when I bought it. So we'll see. But I'm just so glad that the game's starting, man. It's going to be an awesome ride this whole summer.
Mm-hmm. Yes, best of luck. I'm actually going to see this movie one way or another. I don't care if it's good or not. Sure. I'm a sucker for a space movie.
Same here.
Let's move on to what we're watching. We will of course start with our guests and our most distant guest first, Steve Saylor. What have you been watching these days?
I have been watching Doctor Who and Game of Thrones. It is absolutely amazing. I also am watching, I don't know if you guys have checked out the show Elementary. It is it's sort of like the U.S. version of Sherlock Holmes, and it has Johnny Lee Miller and Lucy Liu, which, believe it or not, and it's very sort of predictable because it's obviously a crime sort of serial thing, but I am enjoying every single episode because it's never what you expect, and it's very close to what a Sherlock Holmes mystery would be. I definitely recommend checking that out. What I'm also watching is I found this sort of documentary. I don't know if you guys had seen it or talked about it. It's called Everything or Nothing, and it's actually sort of the behind the scenes story of the James Bond franchise.
I watched that actually. That was good.
Yeah, I was amazed at sort of like I heard about it or something like that, and then I saw it on Netflix, and I was like, yeah, you know what, I'll check it out. And it was absolutely amazing. They have every single Bond in there except for Sean Connery, but you do have sort of archival footage of Sean Connery in interviews and stuff like that talking about it. But it's sort of like a really, really cool in-depth look of what the James Bond franchise has been from Ian Fleming all the way up to present day with Daniel Craig. So I definitely recommend checking that out.
Cool pick. Lamar, I know you're going to make a lot of people in our audience happy because you're watching at least three of these things that you've listed are things people in our audience have been beating us up to watch that we haven't had a chance to.
Yeah, I kind of go off the fringe a little bit, but I'm really enjoying Revolution right now. And I know some people say it's not the best acting.
Has it gotten better? I just thought it was predictable.
I felt it has. They've added a lot more drama to it. You know, I don't want to spoil any of it, but you know, a lot of events are now unfolding, kind of in a Lost scenario, which is funny because the lady that was on Lost is Juliet's one of the stars on it. I like
and
this
Bella's because, dad.
Oh yeah, exactly. I like this series because it's one of those scenarios. Like, what would we do in a situation like this? It's very to me, it feels very kind of realistic, except for the fat guy who's been fat for 15 years, and he's walked thousands and thousands of miles, yet he's still the same size. That does not give me hope for myself at all. Another show, probably my favorite right now, is Kevin Bacon's The Following. Absolutely love this show. This cult leader who's a murderer is trying to be caught by Kevin Bacon. Kevin is fantastic in the show. It feels like 24 to me. Like, it feels like only a few days have really gone by, even though it's been about 6-7 episodes, I believe, maybe a little bit more. And I like that feeling of continuity, that it doesn't break from show to show. So check that one out. I'm watching Psych, which is if you love comedy, Psych is the show to watch, I say for sure. The one that I'm having difficulty with is Once Upon a Time. I want to love it, but the acting is getting progressively worse. But I feel like I've invested so much time into it that I don't want to leave it.
But I hate that feeling where it's like, yeah, no, I can't quit.
Yeah. I mean, I like fantasy. I like those kind of stories, how to tie it in fairy tales. But the acting is getting progressively worse. So I don't know what I'm going to do with that show.
Brian, obviously Game of Thrones. Still watching Doctor Who?
Yeah, this time I sort of phoned it in. Like the kids are really enjoying watching Doctor Who, and you know, this was another Monster of the Week episode. I mean, it was soft for me.
It was the obligatory trip into history episode, and frankly, I never liked those very much. So this was a better one than usual, and you had Davos Seaworth.
Yeah. Okay.
As well as Edmure Tully.
Yeah. Right. Exactly. Well. But the cute thing was watching it with the kids, like this was legit, like the scariest horror movie thing they'd ever seen. And so they all cuddled together with me. And, you know, I forget that I watched this stuff, you know, when I was their age. So it's cool to see it through their eyes. I'm not going to have time to stick around for a spoiler zone, but I did want to talk. I think this is spoiler free. Game of Thrones ended with a very unusual choice on the music at the end. Can we talk about that?
Sure. Yeah. Now, Lamar, did you watch Game of Thrones? I know Steve said he did.
I don't watch it, so you won't be spoiling it for me.
Okay. Yeah. Well, The Bear and the Maiden Fair is a classic song from the Song of Ice and Fire universe. People know it from the books. People have already recorded it before the TV show ever came around. And they've sung it in the show a couple times. But they got a group to actually record it, like an indie rock version for the show, and what was it? What was the name of that group? I had noted it somewhere.
Somebody will have a link to it in the chat room in about 2 seconds. But so now this particular episode ends with a big surprise moment, right? And it's uncomfortable to look at, and
shocker moment.
They wanted to have a shocking.
The Whole Steady is the name of the band.
There you go. But this episode ends with a big shocker. And what they said they wanted to do was create, throw you off kilter with it by all of a sudden throwing an indie rock pop version of The Bear and the Maiden Fair for the credits to roll. All of that makes sense hypothetically. It also undoes so much work that they've done to create a consistent, believable world with Game of Thrones. They have gone so far out of their way to do everything correct. It felt wrong and stupid, the same way seeing a three-eyed crow in New York City flying around during those promos felt like wow, whoever made that ad doesn't get the show, you know, because that's not imagery, you know, that they do. But now apparently they do. I mean, it's like, it makes as much sense if they had just played, you know, Led Zeppelin at the end of it. I did not like it at all. It just took me right out of it.
I will say this. First off, I would love to have Led Zeppelin play at the end of Game of Thrones because that just would be amazing. Favorite band of all time. But the thing is, it's different. Like, interesting is that, okay, I work for a company that actually owns rights to HBO Canada. So I actually I get the screener copies from work of each show on HBO. And I actually watched this episode and it didn't have the song. And it was the most shocking thing I'd ever seen. I'm like it was... I had to actually look it up, the song today, or at least, and I was like, wow, that does seem like it would be very jarring. But to me, it was like, it didn't need that punctuation. Let's just say that.
It was jarring, but I liked it. It reminded me of like a Flogging Molly or Dropkick Murphy's take on a classic Irish tune. And in that respect, I kind of loved it because Jamie Lannister is rock and roll. And so, you know, you want to have some rock and roll there.
People in the chat room are pointing out there's minor spoiler, you know, song All Along the Watchtower shows up in Battlestar Galactica. That's a plot point. That is part of the story. And it's important within the context of the story they're trying to tell. This is just tacked on and complete. And then, you know, Ken from Chicago says, well, what stylistically, maybe it's just like Heath Ledger in A Knight's Tale. It's like, no, that was the story that you did the whole way long. It was the vibe you were going for. This is not the vibe they've ever gone for. It's like a giant record scratch up until this moment has been a fantastically consistent world and tone that they've gone for. And it just threw me off.
So you're not watching Game of Thrones anymore now?
Oh, yeah, okay. Yeah. And you know, I love the show way too much. I mean, it's like, it's fine. It's just, I'm like, that's just weird, Game of Thrones. You didn't need to do that. And, you know, let's stick to your strong suits.
All right. What I've been watching is the stuff you've heard me talking about for weeks now. Mad Men, consistent, not crazy great, but if you like it, you're going to continue to like it. Game of Thrones, you know, as far as the show goes, the show, amazing, ending credits aside. I enjoyed that Doctor Who episode, but I gave you my opinion on that. Orphan Black, I've been kind of watching on a delay, a self-imposed delay. I recorded on Saturdays. I usually don't get around to it till Tuesday or Wednesday. And of course, Archer, season finale, so no more Archer. I'm very, very sad because Archer just had another incredible season. But I wanted to talk, one of the things I watched a lot of this week was the NHL and Major League Baseball on Roku. I paid for the MLB.TV and the NHL Center Ice Packets or Game Center or whatever it's called for the Roku. So when I want to watch my St. Louis Cardinals, I can watch them on my Roku. When I watch the St. Louis Blues, I can watch them on the Roku. And when my wife want to watch the Oakland A's, now we don't live in the market, we can watch them on the Roku. But we're blacked out of any Los Angeles area teams. And here's where it gets interesting. We don't pay for the tier of DirecTV service that gets the local sports channel. So if the Dodgers are the only ones who ever seem to be on broadcast, and that's only like two or three times a week, If we want to watch the local sports teams, we can't because we're blacked out from MLB and NHL, and we'd have to pay an extra $120 a year to get this Fox Sports Prime and Fox Sports West tier that has our actual local sports team. So blacking out the local sports team has actually decreased our ability to watch your local ads. It's not working for us.
Wow.
Sheesh.
Yeah,
maybe you should change your home to Chicago or something so they won't know.
Well, a lot of people are like, yeah, you can VPN, you can do this. I'm like, that's not the point. I actually don't really care about watching those games unless they're playing the Cardinals, or the A's, or the Blues. Then I care. But most of the time, I don't care at all. But I just think it's funny. It's like they black them out to encourage me to go watch them on TV so that I give ratings to the local market. But it's actually having the opposite effect. I'm less likely to watch those games now.
Yeah, I know for a fact that if any local network here blocks any hockey from Canada, you know there's going to be a riot in the streets. I mean, just you've seen what we did in Vancouver. That's nothing compared to if you take away our hockey from us.
Joke around with that stuff. I know.
No.
We should, before we talk about what we're watching, give a shout out to Defiance. Does it start tonight? Is that what it is?
Yeah, that's right. I'm glad you mentioned that. I did have a note in the movie draft section because that's sort of our premiering this week. But yeah, starting tonight is Defiance, sci-fi network thing. It takes place in St. Louis, right?
That's why I came here. I'm doing my show on location of an apocalypse, for sure.
And the video game takes place in San Francisco, so you can play the video game and watch the TV show. And it's got lots of good advanced reviews, so I'm definitely going to check it out.
That's awesome.
Well, Brian, you got the hard out, so you decide. Do we want to get into any feedback, or are we done?
I'll tell you what. I will bow out now. You guys can carry feedback without me. And because basically I just collected – remember last week I said, look, am I the crazy one with 4K displays? And we collected a whole bunch of stuff. So let's go ahead and kick it over to feedback.
Okay.
Now it's time for feedback with Brian and Tom on Frame Rate. Oh, yeah.
Do you have a summary line for this before you go?
The responses are all over the map. I mean, let's just dive into a couple of them. Matthew says, let me explain my excitement. I have a 47-inch 1080p TV. When I watch Blu-ray, I pull my easy chair to approximately 7 inches from the screen, or 7 feet from the screen. Maybe might as well be 7 inches. So I can sit a little closer before being too close. He wants a 70-inch 4K TV so he can sit 3 feet back, basically, 10 or feet so from the screen and feel like he's at a movie theater. No, if what you wanted to do, Matt, was feel like you're in a movie theater, you would watch it in 2K because that's what you watch when you go to the movie theater.
Interesting. Eric says the problem with 4K TV is that it's still at a 16:9 aspect ratio. You're still going to see bars at the top and bottom when watching a movie with the aspect ratio of 241. Unless TVs start being produced in a higher aspect ratio, 4K TVs are worthless. That was true of HD TVs, too. That could eventually be fixed.
Yeah. Andy says, Brian, I'm a programmer. I use this as a way to justify my monitor addiction. I would totally go for a 4K screen and then put up my two larger monitors on the sides of it in portrait mode for a little extra desktop space so things don't feel so cramped. Here's what I love about this. He starts off making a very cogent argument that, like, yeah, I need a giant 4K display so I don't have to have so many monitors. And when I get my 4K display, I could keep putting more monitors around it and make it even bigger, which is, like, I love it. That's ballsy.
And then we got David with a 135-inch screen in his home theater with a digital production 3-chip projector. So he's like, yeah, totally want 4K for my 135-inch screen. Yes, we understand you would want that. That makes
perfect sense. For a blind man, the 135-inch screen, that would be amazing.
Slobber, slobber,
slobber. In that case, do you even, but if you're blind, you don't, I mean, do you even care if it's 4K?
Actually, I do. I watch a lot of, I have an HD TV and it's great and it works fine, but I still have to sit within about less than 3 feet away from the screen in order to be able to do it. And I've been doing this for all my whole life, so I've never known anything beyond that. But seeing a 4K, like when I actually had the chance to see a 4K HD TV, I was like, I could see. Like I felt so like it was like that song. It's like I was blind, but now I see. And wow. The quality was amazing. I want that so badly.
That may be the best use case yet.
Absolutely.
Right there.
Mm-hmm.
That's going to wrap it up for us. Thank you, Steve Saylor, co-founder, co-host of This Week in Geek. Tell folks where they can find your show online.
You can be able to go to thisweekingeek.net. We have tons of great podcasts on there. And don't worry, we're not part of the This Week In or whatever. We had that name a long time ago. Leo gave us permission, so it's totally fine.
Predates.
Yeah, exactly. You can also find me at Steve Saylor on Twitter and stevesaylor.net.
And it's Saylor, S-A-Y-L-O-R, for those on the audio podcast. Also, yes. Big congratulations, Lamar Wilson, on the launch of This Week in YouTube, twit.tv/YT. Where else can folks find you, Lamar?
Thank you so much. You can actually find me on YouTube, if you like, at /Lamar Wilson. That's Lamar with two R's. And on Twitter at Lamar Wilson. So, thanks for having me. Really appreciate it.
That's it for us. You can find us on the web, twit.tv/FR for frame rate. You can also email us framerate@twit.tv and catch us live. We're every Monday, 3:30 p.m. Pacific, 6:30 p.m. Eastern. Our thoughts go out once again to the folks in Boston. Stay safe.
Really? Oh, is that what you want? Like Milton Berle?
Yeah.
Sweet old Korean lady?
Yeah.
Are there more bad guys behind me?
Oh, is that how you want to play it?
Yeah.